Hello again. Well, here we are on our second lecture. I'm recording this for you because I will be out of town tomorrow on Thursday. And Darylin will have it loaded on YouTube either tomorrow or or Friday. I downloaded the notes for this lecture onto the Blackboard, and it's on the home page there. Every day is about your perspective. What is your perspective if you're in 105 degree temperature and you have to be outside in it? Well, if you're from Arizona, Phoenix, Arizona, it's not a big deal. They're accustomed to that. But if you're from Alaska, northern Alaska, 105 degree temperature is sort of unbearable. So the perspective is completely different there. But if you're in 20 or 30 or 40 below in Alaska, and you're from Alaska, the perspective is much different. I think that's a normal day in the wintertime. The perspective for somebody from Arizona at 20 or 30 or 50 below is going to be much different. Every day, we are given a new day. No matter what happened yesterday, no matter what happened a year ago, a month ago, every day is a new day. Today is new. How are you going to face it? What's your perspective going to be on today? Will you be positive or will you not be positive? Tony Robbins says that life is a gift, and it offers us the privilege and the opportunity and the responsibility to give something back by becoming more. Tonight we're going to start with chapter 4. Chapter 4 is an interesting chapter. It's about exercise metabolism. And it's a chapter that you need to pay very close attention to. Because what we're studying tonight has great relevance on what happens later on in this semester. The importance of ATP and the constructs of its metabolic pathways give at least an understanding as to how energy is utilized at rest, at the beginning of exercise, and during the course of exercise, and after exercise. We must recognize that all is not understood about how ATP works. The information that I'm giving you is information from the book, information from things that I've studied in the past about ATP. There's still things we do not understand about how it works. But we do know that ATP is critical to motion, and it's critical to life. Without ATP, as I said last week, there is no life. We know from a simplicity standpoint that oxygen consumption and utilization at a cellular level is a driving factor in ATP production during homeostasis. Now, I want you to understand that the consumption of oxygen during homeostasis, which is a point at which we are at rest, is very critical to ATP production. We know that our intake of oxygen is less during the initial stages of exercise. When you start running, you feel like you're going to need more air. So there's a little less oxygen until we reach that steady state. It's important that you understand the steady state. We went over that last week, and the steady state is the state at exercise where things start to level off. During the first 1 to 4 minutes of exercise, the intake of oxygen is less. And that is called an oxygen deficit. During the oxygen deficit, until the steady state is reached, ATP formation and utilization is anaerobic. Because we are receiving less oxygen, the body starts to produce ATP from an anaerobic state, a state without consumption of oxygen. After the steady state is reached, the aerobic pathway of ATP production becomes primary. I know that this is sort of deceptive, speaking from where we were at last week. Last week we said during homeostasis, it's anaerobic. It's aerobic. It's the consumption of oxygen that produces ATP. This week, we talk about that being true. But when we start talking about a steady state and whether or not it's anaerobic or aerobic, we have to talk about the length of time that we're exercising, about the intensity of exercise, the amount of oxygen that we're intaking, and then we talk about what happens after we exercise. Are we taking in more oxygen? Well, if you're breathing very heavily after you've exercised, then you will definitely start taking in more oxygen. That's the body's way. That's an innate means of us compensating and trying to catch up with the production of ATP. We know that during rest, our blood lactate levels are low. And lactate is a non-fatiguing byproduct of lactic acid. And it's a preferred source of the brain and the heart. Lactic acid, through a metabolic process of glycolysis or gluconeogenesis, becomes glucose. And glucose is a favorite food of the brain and the heart. We also know that oxygen consumption during rest is very low. I'm going to step over here and start the PowerPoints. When we speak about the blood lactate levels being low, we're going to get to that in just a moment, because we're going to talk about what's called the lactate threshold. But suffice it to say, we know that 100% of ATP is produced in aerobic metabolism. We know that the blood lactate levels are low in homeostasis. And we know that the resting oxygen consumption is low. We intake less oxygen because we're not working hard. And that's why the ATP is produced with aerobic consumption of oxygen. State to an exercise state, our intake of oxygen, like I said a moment ago, is less because we're trying to catch up. We're trying to get to that moment of steady state. And that oxygen uptake increases rapidly but not instantaneously. It reaches a steady state within 1 to 4 minutes. The initial ATP production through anaerobic pathways is an ATP PC system. And that system is where phosphocreatine containing a high energy bond is stored in muscle cells. As the creatine phosphate is broken down during the muscle contraction, now a large amount of energy is released and coupled to resynthesize ATP. That process is a very critical process in the production of ATP. Remember that that muscle contraction occurs, and as a result of that, there's a high energy release and the ATP is formed from that. When we talk about glycolysis, anaerobic glycolysis is also called fast glycolysis. It's only effective during short and intense exercise ranging from 10 to 30 seconds. Another name for this system is called the anaerobic lactic acid system. As you'll see on the PowerPoint, and the PowerPoints are loaded on Blackboard also, that after the steady state is reached, the ATP requirement is met through aerobic ATP production. In some ways, that's deceptive, because as you get into high intense exercise, or you get into exercise that is prolonged over a duration, like a marathon, a 10K, something like that, then you're talking about 50% aerobic production of ATP and 50% anaerobic production of ATP. So let's summarize this. Let's say that the oxygen uptake and ATP production and utilization in aerobic versus anaerobic pathway used during exercise follows. With high intensity, short-term exercise, 2 to 20 seconds. That would be something like a sudden burst to go run after a basketball, a sudden burst running a 100-meter dash. Muscle ATP production is dominated by the ATP-PC system. Remember that that system is anaerobic. Intense exercise lasting more than 20 seconds relies more on anaerobic glycolysis to produce the necessary ATP. And high intensity events lasting longer than 45 seconds utilize a combined ATP-PC, which is anaerobic glycolysis, and the aerobic system to produce the needed ATP for muscles. And that's where you talk about receiving that's where you talk about utilizing that aerobic and anaerobic system together. And that's a 50-50 situation. And also the muscle contraction is very critical there, because that's part of the energy formation. And it's this system that I just talked about, this high-intensity system, will last 2 to 3 minutes. And that's a 50-50 aerobic to anaerobic process. The energy used to perform prolonged exercise longer than 10 minutes primarily comes from aerobic metabolism. The steady state of oxygen intake and uptake can be generally maintained during prolonged, moderate, intense exercise. We have to remember that environmental conditions like heat on a humid day or exercise in a high work rate causes an upward drift in oxygen consumption. When you talk about an upward drift of oxygen consumption, that means you're having to intake more oxygen. So when you're in a very humid atmosphere, you have to intake more oxygen. Why is that? I guess the best way to answer that is that when there's a lot of moisture in the air, it seems to capture more of the oxygen molecules. So that when we intake that oxygen, we're having to intake more oxygen. That's the upward drift of oxygen intake. Because there's more moisture, more H2O, more water in the air. So in order for us to intake a proper amount of oxygen to produce ATP, then we have to intake more oxygen, because we have to extract more of that oxygen from the water that's being taken in the air. You probably have heard a term called maximum oxygen uptake. And that's the maximum capacity to transport and utilize oxygen during exercise. It's either called the maximum oxygen uptake, or it's called the VO2 max. For our purposes, we're going to call it the VO2 max. We do that because it just, that's what I'm going to use. It's just easier for me to say VO2 max than to say maximum oxygen uptake with my deep southern drawl. As I mentioned a moment ago, post-exercise, after exercise, especially after intense exercise or after prolonged exercise, we have an increased oxygen intake. The slide here says it's an oxygen uptake remains elevated above rest into recovery. With excess post-exercise oxygen consumption, the EPOC, we have to talk about the amount of oxygen that's necessary to repay the amount of oxygen that we've lost in the midst of all of this exercise. That's why recovery and rest is a very critical issue in us recovering our ability to produce ATP, in us, in our muscles being able to go into a rest state to recover from an electrolyte standpoint, because all of these things are very critical when we start talking about producing ATP and we start talking about the ability of the muscle to contract, the ability of the muscle to relax, and all of that stuff is working together all the time. So if we don't have a resting state, we never get to that point where the amount of oxygen we're intaking finally gets to this repaid state. At first, we're intaking that oxygen very rapidly. Then as we start to recover, all of that starts to slow down and we start going into that state that we call homeostasis again. Restoring the oxygen and the phosphocreatine stores to the muscle is typically completed within 2 to 3 minutes. That's with someone who's actually exercising often. So let's simplify this process a little bit. After we're finished exercising, we're breathing rapidly. So we're having an increased amount of oxygen. 20% of the oxygen debt is used to convert the lactate that's produced during exercise. Where's that lactate in homeostasis? It's a low amount of lactate. But right after we've exercised, the amount of lactate in the blood has drastically increased. So we take that lactate produced during exercise, and glucose is produced in a process called gluconeogenesis. That's synthesis of glucose from a non-carbohydrate source. And what I mean by that is lactate is not a carbohydrate. What are the basic carbohydrates? You have glucose, fructose, and lactose, not lactate. Lactate is a byproduct of lactic acid. And as we said earlier, lactate being converted into glucose is a very favorite food of not only the heart, not only the brain, but also of the muscle. All of this is a recovery state for that muscle. I said that there's a lot of things that are not understood about ATP production and ATP utilization. We have gluconeogenesis. We also have glycolysis. We also have the Krebs cycle, which occurs directly inside the mitochondria of the cell. And we have the ATP-PC system, and we have what's called the Cori cycle that occurs in the liver, and it's utilized through the blood. All of those processes are used to produce ATP. When we talk about the majority of lactic acid is converted to glucose in the liver, at that point we're talking about the Cori cycle. There's some evidence now that 70% of the lactic acid is oxidized. And it's used as a substrate by the heart and by the skeletal muscle. And 20% of it is converted to glucose. And 10% is to amino acids. There's still a lot of study going on about this. It's important to remember that lactic acid is removed more rapidly with light exercise in recovery. The optimal intensity is 30 to 40% of VO2 max. Now there's an argument that increased body temperature during exercise results in an increased metabolic rate. Would you agree with that? I think that that's probably fairly realistic. I think when we talk about the body temperature increasing some during exercise, that it does increase the metabolic rate. I don't think there's any real question about that, but there is some argument now that the high levels of release of epinephrine and norepinephrine during this increased O2 oxygen consumption after exercise also helps produce ATP. It also helps metabolize lactate. The problem with that argument is that epinephrine and norepinephrine dissipate almost immediately post-exercise. So there's almost no way that as a hormone they could come in there and produce an ATP from that. So let's go back over it again. And I keep going back over this because it's so critical that you know what's happening with that athlete or with that person that you're working with their body in the midst of this. Because when they start getting extremely fatigued, you need to know why. The first 1 to 5 seconds of exercise, ATP is produced what? It's produced anaerobically through the ATP-PC system. Intense exercise, longer than 5 seconds, ATP production occurs through glycolysis. Glycolysis goes right into the Krebs cycle, right into the mitochondria. In any event lasting longer than 45 seconds, we have ATP production through ATP-PC, glycolysis, and aerobic systems. So all of those are working together to produce the necessary ATP so that muscle can contract and relax, contract and relax, contract and relax. 70% anaerobic and 30% aerobic at 60 seconds. But after you get to 2 minutes, 50% of it is aerobic and 50% of it is anaerobic production of ATP. When we talk about prolonged exercise, greater than 10 minutes, the ATP production is primarily for aerobic metabolism. That occurs because we're now at a steady state where we're intaking oxygen at a very steady rate. And so the oxygen that we're intaking is working very smoothly in the midst of that steady state for us to produce ATP. Now, what changes that? Remember that when you're in a very hot, humid atmosphere, all of that changes. Because of why? Because we're intaking air that has a lot of water in it. So we have to be able to remove that oxygen from the H2O and utilize it. So that's why it's a little more difficult when you're in a hot, humid atmosphere for it to be mostly aerobic. Prolonged atmosphere, here we are in a hot, humid environment again. We talk about that upward drift. That upward drift occurs because of what I just said. Because there's more water in the air. The oxygen uptake increases linearly until maximum oxygen uptake or the VO2 max is reached. What's the VO2 max? What is the VO2 max? That's when we're starting to consume the maximum amount of oxygen that we can consume. No further increase in VO2 with an increased work rate. So we have a physiological ceiling, and we have a ceiling that's affected by genetics and by training. There are some people who genetically can exercise longer, and some people can only exercise for a short distance. Does that make them better or worse athletes? No, not really. I would use the argument that Usain Bolt is probably a pretty fair athlete, and he doesn't do well after about 400 meters. But up until then, he's kicking it, and he has that ability to really utilize his oxygen. Now, there are some people, marathoners, there are some people who genetically and through training are able to reach this physiological ceiling differently at the VO2 max because of where they're at. The physiological factors, they vary. Your book talks about the maximum ability of the cardiorespiratory system to deliver oxygen to the muscles. There's also the ability of the muscles to use oxygen to produce ATP aerobically. All of those things are very critical in our production of ATP. Now I want to talk about lactate and the lactate threshold. We talked about that earlier, and to reiterate, during homeostasis, lactate is at a very low level in the blood. But as we exercise, as lactic acid is produced, a layman's term for lactic acid would be muscle sweat. But saying that muscle is sweating into the blood. But lactate is produced in the midst of lactic acid production. During exercise, the lactate in the blood the lactic acid rises symmetrically during the incremental exercise. So as we reach 50 to 60% of the VO2 max, in an untrained subject, it's going to be different at higher work rates at a 65 to 80% VO2 max in trained subjects. That's when the lactic acid systematically is released into the blood. Practical uses. In a few weeks, we're going to start talking about a fit prescription. We have to be able to understand that when we talk about prediction of performance combined with VO2 max. And we have to talk about planning the intensity of training programs and choosing training heart rates. There's four theoretical reasons for blood increased blood lactate during graded exercise. One of them is decreased muscle oxygen. The other one is increased or accelerated glycolysis due to hormone release of epinephrine and norepinephrine. There's also the idea that fast muscle fiber recruitment is occurring, and that's assisting in that lactate production. And there's also the idea that reduced rate of lactate removal. What good is that for us to know as coaches, as trainers, as doctors? What good is that for us to know? We have to know it for this reason. From a practical standpoint, it tells us, it gives us a perspective in predicting the endurance and the performance as a marker for the training intensity. So we can predict at that point, due to the amount of lactate, due to the lactate threshold, we can predict endurance performance, and we can predict the amount of intensity that the training, that person can go through in the midst of training. We also need to talk about fuel utilization during exercise. There's a respiratory exchange ratio. There's the percentage of carbohydrates and fats that are being converted to energy metabolism. And the ratio of carbon dioxide output. And the volume of oxygen consumed in the midst of that. And I don't know if we have a slide on that or not, but check. When we talk about fuel utilized for exercise, types of fuels we have carbohydrates, we have fats, we have proteins. Proteins help to build muscle mass, but their role is very minor during exercise and for the production of ATP, probably about 10%. Now when we talk about fat and carbohydrates, their role is very major during exercise. Fat is the primary source of energy during low-intensity exercise. And carbohydrates serve as the major fuel source during high-intensity exercise. That stands to reason. Okay, here we are back to those cycles I was talking about. Glycogen is depleted during high intensity exercise. A reduced rate of glycolysis leads to the production of pyruvate. And reduced Krebs cycle intermediates. Remember that the Krebs cycle occurs in mitochondria. There's great discussion about whether or not the Krebs cycle is aerobic or anaerobic because of pyruvate, because of glycogen, but the reduced fat oxidation and fats are metabolized by the Krebs cycle. This is a very critical thing to remember. Depletion of muscle and blood carbohydrate stores contributes to fatigue. Good to know what the sources of fuel are during exercise. Why would we want to know that? Well, when we're training people, when we're trying to improve someone's health, we want to know what they're putting in their mouth. Are they drinking enough water? Are they intaking the proper kinds of carbohydrates? Are they intaking protein? Are they intaking any fat? Contrary to popular belief in the medical world, it's important that we have some fat in our diet. Glycogen in our blood glucose from liver glycogenolysis. Once again, the cortisol cycle. We have intramuscular triglycerides. What are those? That's fat. That's fat inside the muscle. And we have plasma free fatty acids. Proteins, as we know, are broken down into amino acids, and only about 2% of the total energy production during exercise for fuel. So proteins typically are for amino acid production. Back to lactate. It's a critical component of producing glucose. It's a critical component of our ability to produce ATP. It's used as a fuel source by the skeletal muscle in the heart, and it's converted to acetyl-CoA, and it enters into the Krebs cycle. Where does the Krebs cycle occur? It occurs in the mitochondria. And it's converted to glucose in the liver. Anytime lactate is converted to glucose in the liver, that occurs through the Cori cycle. And then we have the lactate shuttle, where lactate is produced in one tissue and transported to another. I want to move on to chapter 6 now. And chapter 6 is about the immune system and exercise. This is an interesting chapter to me because, you know, there's so many reasons to exercise. And one of the reasons to exercise is that it increases your immune system. It increases your immunity to problematic things like external ingestions of things like that would cause the flu or cause a bacterial infection. When people are exercising, their immune system is boosted. It's boosted because of B cell production, T cell production. It's boosted because the neutrophils increase with exercise, with prolonged exercise training. The natural killer cells are increased as a result of increased exercise and training. So, is it important to exercise to improve your immune system? Yeah, it's very important. We have two systems. We have an innate system and we have an acquired immune system. When we talk about an innate system or an innate immune system, this system provides our internal and external defenses. The external defenses of the innate system are the skin, mucous membranes that line the respiratory system, mucous membranes that line the digestive system, and mucous membranes that line the genitourinary tracts. All of those are part of an innate immune system. The internal defense is composed of specific cells such as phagocytes and natural killer cells. So we have within an innate immune system, we have an external and we have an internal defense. Internal is the production of phagocytes and natural killer cells. External is our skin membrane. It's the mucous membrane inside the respiratory system, digestive system, and the genitourinary tracts. Now, the acquired immune system is a little different, and the primary function or purpose of the acquired system is to protect against viruses, since the innate immune system cannot eliminate most viruses. The two major cells involved in the acquired immune system are the B cells, or the B lymphocytes, and the T lymphocytes. And those are what we call the B cells and the T cells. B cells combat against bacterial and viral infections by secreting antibodies directly into the blood. And the T cells are produced in the bone marrow and mature in the thymus organ. And T cells do not produce antibodies, but they recognize protein antigens in the body. They're very critical in fighting off AIDS or the HIV virus. This is what I was talking about earlier. Moderate, regular exercise, it protects against upper respiratory tract infections. That's what URTI is. 20 to 40 minutes of exercise at 50 to 70% of a heart rate max is sufficient. The resistance exercise may also be very beneficial in increasing the ability or reducing the risk of a URTI. The possible mechanism, these are not entirely all known, but the possible mechanisms are this, that exercise causes a boost in the innate and the acquired immune system, the natural killer cells, and the neutrophils. It increases the amount of antibodies, and it returns to a normal level in about 3 hours. Other factors associated with exercise are less emotional stress, better nutrition, and adequate sleep. Last week, I talked about how critical it is that people rest. I don't mean sleeping 12 hours a day. Honestly, I think that's ridiculous. But it's important that most people get a 6 to 8 hour window where they truly rest, where they sleep. Is rest during the day important? If you've been exercising all day, it's important to take a moment and rest. And I'm not talking about sleeping then, but I'm talking about rest, letting your body catch up. Increasing the quality of food that you intake is so important, and hopefully later on in this semester I will get to a very elaborate means of introducing how we are supposed to eat, how we are supposed to teach people how to eat, so that we can improve not only their physical health, but also their immune system. An interesting factor in people who do prolonged exercise is that those people are at risk temporarily of infection. Because prolonged exercise, say you're going out and running a 10K or you're going out and running a marathon, it has a depressive effect on the immune system. There's an open window here of increased infection in people who do high intensity, long duration aerobic exercise. It may also be due to other factors. And you know, we can talk about those other factors. Those other factors are that when you talk about people who run marathons, first of all, they're very touchy about their weight. And a lot of them do not eat well. If you look at long distance female runners, they have a very high tendency to fractures in their feet because of osteoporosis. That's also a reason, that's also a problem because they're not eating properly and they don't have a proper calcium-magnesium ratio into their system. And they don't in intake large doses of carbohydrates because they're afraid of gaining weight. And so those types of people, those types of athletes are at risk of upper respiratory infections. They're at risk of all types of other infections, excuse me, because if you're training them, you have to pay very close attention to how they're eating. Last week we talked about exercise in intense environments, in extreme environments. We've talked about that some tonight when we talked about exercising in a very hot and humid atmosphere. The interesting thing about the risk of infection in people who train in extreme environments is that if they're in a hot environment, their cortisol levels are elevated compared to a cool environment. But the interesting thing about that is that there's no impairment to their immune function. It pretty much stays steady. So They are still increasing their B cells. They're still increasing their T cells. They're still increasing their ability to produce phagocytes and natural killer cells. Now, when we talk about exercise in the cold, it does not have a negative effect on the immune system. It's interesting that new studies are out now that says repeated bouts of exercise in extreme cold increases your B cells, it increases your T cells, it increases your neutrophils, and it increases your natural killer cells. And as a result of that, it increases your immune system. Is there a difference? I want you to think about this. I want you to study this a little bit. Look it up. Is there a difference in the number of infections that people acquire who live in environments such as northern Alaska, environments such as northern Russia, environments near the Arctic Circle, or near Antarctica? Is their incidence of infection greater or less? Especially those people who are outside working in those environments and maybe even exercising in those environments. Is their propensity to infection less? I think that's a very interesting study. As opposed to people who live in extreme heat. Think about this. People who live at the equator, where it's very humid. People in the jungles, do they have a higher incidence of infections? Especially people who are living outside, who have to search for their own food outside, who work outside in those atmospheres. Work equates to exercise. Do they have a boosted immune system? Do they have a higher incidence of disease than people who live in very cold atmospheres who are outside all the time? I think that's a very good comparison. And I think when we talk about exercise in extreme environments. We also need to talk about people who live in those environments and work in those environments. Because sometimes some of you will be placed in a position, maybe, where you get to work with people who are in very cold environments or very hot environments. More likely in very hot environments. Not many people want to go to those extreme cold environments. Last week I talked about my son, who's he's a retired airborne infantry guy, and he's a beast. He works out all the time. He has a very high intense work job where his job is physically very demanding, and he works out in the cold all the time in northern Alaska. And when he goes to the gym, he's a mile and a half from the gym at his house. He doesn't drive his car. It's part of his cardio workout to walk to the gym. And the other day I told you he walked to the gym at 43 below. That's not unusual for him. And people who live in those atmospheres, they're out in that temperature all the time and they don't think much of it. Is his immune system better? I don't know that that guy has been sick in years. He's just one example. But I don't think in the last 5 years since he's been there that he's had even a cold. But it's important to remember that when we talk about the immune system, does our immune system improve with exercise? I don't think there's any question about that. I think over the course of 25 years of clinical practice, I've seen most people who are athletes or true athletes who work out, who train on a daily basis, it's very seldom that those people are sick. There's always this question about whether or not we should exercise if we have an upper respiratory tract infection, or if we have a cold, if we have a runny nose, if we have nasal congestion or a sore throat. We probably should reduce the intensity of the workout. Why? Because we need to make sure we're getting enough oxygen intake. We need to make sure we get rest. We need to make sure that we try to get well. Most people who exercise frequently, often, who train daily, or at least 3 to 5 times a week, most of those people recover much faster from a cold, much faster from a viral infection, because their immune system is boosted. Do all of them exercise during the times that they have colds? Some of them do, and some of them do okay with it. But when you have an upper respiratory tract infection in your chest, it's probably a good idea if you have fever, fatigue, if you have widespread muscle aches, it's probably not a good idea to go and exercise. It's probably a good idea to sit down, lay down, and rest. And try to get well. So, you know, there's always this old adage that we are told, and I don't know if you were ever told this as a kid, but don't go outside if it's cold. Don't stay outside and run and play in the cold because you'll end up getting a cold. And honestly, I think that that's nonsense. I think that there's more evidence every day and it helps boost our immune system. That's going to conclude our class for today. Next week, we will have an examination. That examination will involve some things about homeostasis, some things about steady state, and it also will involve chapter 4, which is exercise metabolism, and chapter 6, exercise in the immune system. I don't look for it to be an extremely difficult test, but the way I typically design tests, I don't usually use a test bank from a textbook. I may at some point during the semester here. But on this test probably will involve some questions where you have to write your answers and submit them back to me. When we have this, I will put the test on Blackboard for you to take. And what you have to do is you have to take that test and you have to submit it back to me within 48 hours. I think that's ample time, and I think it gives you an opportunity to restudy the material, to get a better grasp on the material at that point. I'll try to have that put up on Blackboard by Wednesday or Thursday, by Wednesday of next week, but for sure by Thursday next week. Have an awesome week. Remember that your perspective in your life is so critical to what happens in other people's lives. It's not all about you, but you are an important factor in their life. Have an awesome week. Have fun. Be joyful and be blessed. Good night.